Please, let's bow our heads in prayer. Father, what a real thrill it is to be here in your presence today, to feel your spirit move amongst your people in the way that it only does when we gather together in your name. Let that spirit impart to each one of us something really special, something tangible, something that we can go home clinging to and reveling and celebrating and worshiping you for having had the pleasure of being in your presence. Do something in our hearts and in our minds with the message from your word today. And all this we ask in the blessed, beautiful name of Jesus. Amen. I am really hot. And I don't mean that kind of hot. That kind of hot. No? Wow. Maybe turn me down just a hair. The input, please. Thank you. Okay, so last week we began our journey through the life of Jesus in real time by looking into the life and times of the gospel writers and the unique attributes of each writer's account. It is it's really an eclectic group that God has brought together to preserve his story of redemption. If you think about it, we have a tax collector, a physician, a man who probably worked in ministry for all of his adult life. And today, we will look at a fourth gospel account, which was written by a commercial fisherman. This is quite a wide swath of the ancient world society. This is professionals and working class. And get this, and please remember this, if you haven't heard this before, God does not necessarily call the qualified. By his grace and power, he qualifies whom he calls. The calling comes with the qualification. What the writers of the gospel show us without words is the power of God to transform any one of us into something that we never dreamed we could be. Think about it. Do you think a single one of these men sat around as a child or a teenager and thought, when I grow up, you know, I want to be a witness to the greatest events that ever happened in human history, and under the guidance of God himself, write an account of what I saw that will be translated into every language known to man and be read by people for almost 2,000 years and change the eternal destiny of people from every corner of the world. Who sat down one day and said, I want to be that when I grow up? Nobody. Nobody. Nobody's that arrogant, I think. And yet it happened by God. But God. And make no mistake that these men are not special in and of themselves. I know we all look at them that way today, but they're not. This didn't happen to them because they were special. God did not choose them for this because of anything within them. All these men did to qualify themselves for a calling like this was to accept the hand of God's friendship extended to them by Jesus and surrendered themselves to the guidance of his spirit dwelling within them. They simply believed in Jesus and submitted themselves to his lordship, and boom. If that's all that it takes to be used powerfully by God, imagine what he could do with you. If you will just believe and submit yourself to Jesus. So this week we look at the fourth stupidly ordinary man, ordinary human being who recorded the actions and words of Jesus and recorded the events that took place during his life as one of us. So as we go through this, keep in mind that John today may be considered one of the greats of the faith, and he is. Absolutely. He was a founding father of the Church of Jesus Christ, but he is not considered such because he was actually great. The greatness came from following Jesus and the indwelling of his spirit. If John had a manufacturer's tag hanging off of his neck, it would say product of the grace of God. And that is our fourth gospel writer. Account of Jesus' life and ministry, the gospel according to John. Now, I didn't mention it last week, and I should have. The word gospel in the original Greek literally means good tidings or good news. So this is the good news according to John. We have four accounts of this good news. Now, as with the three synoptic gospels that we looked at last week, the writer does not come out and specifically identify himself. He does, however, give us quite a few internal clues to help us identify him. The writer makes clear by his intimate knowledge of Jewish customs, festivals, and beliefs that he was a Jew. Now, just this week, I was having a discussion with somebody, and actually, a couple hundred years ago, they were doubting the authorship of John because he was way off on some things geographically. He said this town was over here, or we went this way to go here. And what happens in the Middle East, in Israel, it happens a lot. Towns get overthrown, and one of two things happens. They either push a bunch of dirt over it and rebuild on the same spot, or they move another mile down the shore. But in the last 100 years, as archaeology in Israel has, every single geographical landmark named in John's gospel has been found. Every bit of it. All the things that they doubted, he nailed it. They were wrong. They were wrong. John nailed everything. And so that's gone away. But so we know that he was a Jew. He was intimate with the geography of Israel. And so he was a native to the area that he describes. Much better than the guys who come 100 years, 200, 300 years later and want to go, oh, no, I don't think he did that. Okay. Now, he does tell us that he is an eyewitness to the events that he is recording in John 19:35 and 21:24. He says, I'm an eyewitness. So in this gospel account, one of Jesus' disciples is regularly and only referred to as the disciple whom Jesus loved, rather than by a given name. We see that in John 13:23, 19:26, 21:2. 7 and 20. So, from that last passage, chapter 21, verse 20, if you read through down to verse 24, you will see that the disciple whom Jesus loved is also the writer of this gospel. So, who is the disciple whom Jesus loved? From John 13, 23, we know that the disciple whom Jesus loved was seated next to Jesus at the Last Supper, and is leaning in his head against his chest. They called his bosom. They're bosom buddies. That was terrible. Anyways, they were up against each. This guy is so intimate that he's leaning into, physically leaning into Jesus. So we know that he was very close. When Jesus said that one of them was going to betray him, Peter motions to this guy, ask him who it was. Who is it? We don't know. Tell us. Ask him. You're right there. Ask him. Now, obviously, he thought he would answer this guy. Why didn't Peter just ask him? We also know that the disciple whom Jesus loved, because Peter was asking him, is not Peter. We also know it's not Andrew, Nathaniel, Philip, Thomas, Judas Iscariot, or the other Judas, because they're all mentioned by name somewhere in the text. That knocks it down to four. No reason to suddenly start referring to him, one of them, in this way, if they're already named. And they are Thomas. If you want to know the most about Thomas, go to John. John talks about Thomas a lot. We know from chapter 21 that the disciples were, what disciples or which disciples were present at the breakfast on the shore of the Sea of Galilee, and they were Peter, Thomas, Nathanael, the sons of Zebedee, and two other unnamed disciples, seven in total. Three were named specifically, and two were unnamed. We know it's not one of them, because the other two weren't named at all. If one of them was the disciple whom Jesus loved, you'd think that would rate mentioning when you're given the list of everybody who's there. It would be Peter, Nathanael, Thomas, the disciple whom Jesus loved, the sons of Zebedee, and some other guy. But he didn't do that. The sons of Zebedee are never mentioned by name anywhere in John's text, period. In fact, this is the only mention of them at all in John's entire gospel account. So, it's most likely one of them, and they're referred to this way. From verse 21-23 in the same story, we also know that a rumor was started among the brethren that the disciple whom Jesus loved would not die until after Jesus' return. Now, know that this gospel was written in the 90s AD, so this was written down quite some time later. And we know that from Acts 12, 1 and 2, that James was one of the very first apostles to be martyred. So this occurred it's so quickly after Jesus' departure that he could not possibly have written the book, and he certainly wouldn't, there'd be no rumor, or it would have died awfully quick. That would have circulated that he would live until Jesus returned. However, his brother lived to be an old man, very old, the only apostle not martyred. So by process of elimination, we can say that there are definite clues within the text that point to the identity of the disciple whom Jesus loved, and thus the writer of the gospel as being none other than John, the son of John ben Zebedee. Cannot say it with 100% certainty just from that, but all the clues that we have absolutely point in that direction. So that's internally how we know. Externally, church history unanimously attributes this writing to the Apostle John. Not the critics on the outside, but church history unanimously attributes this writing to the Apostle John. Polycarp of Smyrna, who lived from 69 to 156 AD and was a direct disciple of John the Apostle, served under him, testified that John the Apostle was the writer of this book. Irenaeus of Gaul lived from 130 to 102 AD. He was a direct disciple of Polycarp. And he also consistently and explicitly identified John the Apostle as the writer of this book. So if you look at how their lives overlap, you can determine that right up until the end of his life, he never wavered. Polycarp always said, and was still testifying, that his mentor in the faith, John the Apostle, wrote this book. So we have internal clues and external witnesses that all say John, the son of Zebedee, apostle of Jesus Christ, was the writer of this book, an eyewitness to the life and ministry that he describes. So, what do we know about John? We probably know more about John than all the other writers combined, because he lived so long, so he got to do a lot of stuff. John, along with his brother James, were fishermen who worked for their father Zebedee, and he was very close to Jesus, so a lot of the story gets. A lot of the other gospel writers do talk about him. Most believe that John was the unnamed man who, along with Andrew, left following John the Baptizer to follow Jesus in John 1, 35 through 42. This would make John ben Zebedee one of Jesus' first two disciples, at least on a part-time basis. No one walked with Jesus longer than John the Apostle. We'll talk more about that when we get to it in the text. Some also speculate that John Ben Zebedee did not name himself in his gospel except when he absolutely had to, so that readers would not be confused by there being two prominent Johns in the narrative of Jesus' life. Matthew, Mark, and Luke all refer to John as John the Baptist when he is mentioned outside of actually doing baptizing. John doesn't. Just calls him John, which would be confusing. And any of the people he was writing to, if you remember from his letters, he never signed them with his name. So they knew it was his writing style to never sign or portray himself within the text. So if he's sending it to people familiar with him, to keep from confusing them, which John they're talking about, he didn't. He only mentioned John the Baptizer. Now, Jesus called John and his brother James officially into full-time ministry while they were mending nets with their father on the shore of the Sea of Galilee in Matthew 4, 21 and 22. He was a part of Jesus' inner circle along with his brother James and Peter. We know this because Jesus on occasion took only the three of them and left the other three behind. They witnessed several things firsthand that the other nine did not. The raising of Jairus' daughter and the thing above all things, and I hope I'm not giving away something I'm supposed to say later, the transfiguration of Christ on the top of Mount Hermon. Can you imagine getting to be present for that? When what's inside of Jesus finally leaks its way out, that's always there. The miracle is that he's able to hold it in. It's not that it happened. That wasn't the miracle. The miracle was every day that Jesus kept all of that under wraps. And that one event, they were told to keep to themselves until after the resurrection. You see that in Matthew 19. And in fact, Matthew and Mark both record that they were told to zip it. Now, John, along with his brother James, were nicknamed, as we talked about last week, the Sons of Thunder, which has to be the greatest nickname by Jesus ever. It sounds cool, but it's probably not given to him because it was cool. Because they, you know, Jesus, they won't be nice to us. Can we call down some fire from heaven and take care of them all? Burn them, burn them. So it's probably not cool, but it sure sounds cool. He was the only disciple who was listed as being present at Jesus' crucifixion. The disciple whom Jesus loved was the only disciple listed at Jesus' crucifixion in John 19, 26. He and or his family were well known, actually it had to be him, well known and had friends among the Jewish leaders, including the high priest. We see this in John 18, 15 and 16 when John's able to get into the high priest's courtyard on the night when all heck is breaking loose. And as such, he was privy to information on some of the behind-the-scenes plotting that was happening against Jesus. We see that in John 11, 15 through 57, when they were all, okay, he's got to die now. He raised Lazarus from the dead. That's it. He has to die, and it's better that he dies than the whole nation get wiped out, because he's going to start a revolution. And oh, little did they know, they were right. But so thus, John had some friends in high places, Jesus, and some low places, the high priest and the Sanhedrin. And being at that at Jesus' death on the cross, he was entrusted to care for Jesus' mother after his death. You see that in John 19, 26 and 27. This indicates that he had a home and the means to care for her. Jesus isn't just going to give her to somebody who doesn't have the ability, which further continues to knock down the claim that the disciples of Jesus were all young, easily impressionable, and illiterate. That's why they keep putting that out there. They want you to think that these were a bunch of teenagers who follow geeks and gurus they're easily impressionable. These were not. I'm not saying there weren't one or two of them in there. That's entirely possible. But many of them were adults with lives and families and money that they had to sacrifice to follow Christ. They knew what they were doing, and they chose Jesus. John was the first to believe that Jesus had risen from the dead, while others thought that someone had simply moved or taken his body. We see that in chapter 20, verse 8. He was the first to recognize Jesus on the shore of Galilee for breakfast that morning in John 21, 1 through 7. Church history holds that despite several attempts to kill John, that he was the only apostle to be martyred and die of old age around 98 A.D. That's a lot to know. I mean, compare that to what we know about all the other writers. We know a lot about John. The date and location of writing. Where was this written? While we are sure of the writer's identity and know the most about the writer himself, the date of writing is more obscure. It's generally held that this book was written towards the end of John's life, around 90 AD. Church history holds that after serving the church in Jerusalem, John the Apostle relocated to Ephesus in Asia, and it was there in Ephesus that he wrote this account. He also spent time as a prisoner in a penal colony on the island of Patmos, during which time he received and wrote down the visions that are today known as the Book of the Revelation of Jesus Christ. Who was John writing to? Unlike the other three, there are really no discernible clues within the text to indicate that John had a specific audience in mind while writing. John gives us the reason, however, for this writing in chapter 20, verses 30 and 31. And truly Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. This book is all about giving you proof of Jesus' identity as the only begotten of God, so that you would believe in him and have life. To drive that point home, you only need look at the words John uses. John uses the word believe, believed, believes, or believing 66 times. You think, well, they all did. By contrast, Matthew uses those words 10 times. Mark, only 5. And Luke, a total of 9. 666%, I think, more times does John use, because that's what he wants us to do. That's what he wants it to lead us to, that we know and we believe. Therefore, we can safely say that John's gospel is for anyone who doesn't believe or needs to believe again that Jesus is the Son of God. That means it's for all of us. It's for everybody. Theme. What's his point? From verse 1 to the close of the book, the author's purpose is, I think, brilliantly clear. See it in his mission statement: to show that Jesus is in fact the Christ, the incarnation of the living God, Yahweh. Everything else. What else do we know? Matthew gave us... I am so sorry. It is allergy season and I am dying. Okay. Matthew gave us Jesus' legal genealogy through his adopted father, Joseph. And Luke gave us his biological genealogy through his mother, Mary. John, however, gives us Jesus' spiritual or theological lineage in the first verse of the first chapter. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And that's where we'll be next week. As I mentioned before, John makes his purpose clear with his mission statement in John 20, 30, and 31. Worth reading again. And truly Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written. I chose these ones. God wanted me to highlight these ones that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. This gospel is not so much a life of Jesus as it is a powerful presentation of his deity. It's not just John's premise that Jesus is God in the flesh. He shows us 8 times that Jesus himself stated his divine identity. 7 times in the 7 I am statements. 7 times Jesus takes the name of the eternal God, first given to Moses in Exodus 3:14. God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, thus you shall say to the children of Israel, I am has sent me to you. Jesus takes this name 7 specific times. 7 I am statements of God, of Jesus. I am the bread of life, John 6:35. I am the light of the world, 8:12. I am the door of the sheep, 10:7. I am the good shepherd, 10:11. I am the resurrection and the life, 11:25. I am the way, the truth, and the life, 14:6, and I am the true vine, 15:1. In case you misunderstand what he is saying, he makes himself abundantly clear when speaking to the Pharisees in the temple in John 8:58. Jesus said to them, most assuredly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. And the Pharisees knew exactly what he was saying, because they tried to kill him. On the spot, they picked up stones and were going to stone him because he was blaspheming. He was claiming to be God. They knew it. They heard it. The reaction tells you exactly what Jesus meant to say. Now, there's an 8th time, and actually, it looks like I just miscounted because there was 9 times total, but there's an 8th time that Jesus takes this ancient sacred name of God upon himself. It's not considered one of the I am statements, nor was the previous one. But he simply states it as his identity, and what happens when he does this time is stunning. John 18:1-6. When Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples over the brook Kidron, where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. And Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, for Jesus often met there with his disciples. Then Judas, having received a detachment of troops and officers from the chief priests and Pharisees, came there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. So there is a big group of people. A whole detachment plus Judas plus guys from the high priest's office. Jesus, therefore, knowing all things that would come upon him, went forward and said to them, whom are you seeking? They answered him, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus said to them, I am. And Judas, who betrayed him, also stood there with him. Now when he said to them, I am, they drew back and fell to the ground. Jesus, speaking his name, knocked them all over. That's incredible. John also records 7 miracles performed by Jesus. He refers to them as signs because they point to Jesus' divinity. First one is the changing of water to wine in John 2:1-12. Second is the healing of the nobleman's son in John 4:46 through 54. The healing of the paralytic at the pool of Bethesda, John 5:1 through 9. Feeding of the 5,000, John 6:1 through 5. Jesus walking on water, chapter 6:16 through 25. The healing of the man born blind. That's a big one. That's a huge one. Chapter 9, verses 1 through 7, and the raising of Lazarus from the dead. The only one that beats the guy born blind was bringing somebody back from the dead. Jesus kicked it up a notch for the final one. And that was in chapter 11, 38 through 44. Now, six of those miracles are only found in John's account. The feeding of the 5,000 is recorded by all four gospel writers. So you have seven I am statements, seven times where Jesus says, make no mistake, I'm God. And seven miracles, or as John calls them, signs. Seven in the Bible is the number of completion and perfection. This is everything you need to see or hear or read to perfectly know and thus believe that Jesus is God. Jesus is Yahweh in human flesh. The book of John is the complete, perfect witness to the deity of Jesus. John's gospel writing, gospel being written later than the other three, seems to be filling in gaps. With the rise of Gnosticism, which challenged or called into question the deity of Jesus, John has written an account which emphasizes that aspect, the deity of Jesus. It's visible in the synoptics. Don't think you only have to see it in John. It's everywhere, but John really is driving that point home. Clement of Alexandria, speaking concerning the gospel accounts, is quoted as saying, "Last of all, John, perceiving that the external facts had been made plain, composed a spiritual gospel." The book is divided into six parts: the preexistence of John in chapter 1, verses 1 through 18. Jesus' first year of ministry covers from John 1:19 through John 4:54. Jesus' popularity, rising popularity during the second year of his ministry, covered in chapter 5. The growing opposition probably is a direct result of that growing popularity in his second year. The opposition comes chapter 6 through chapter 12, verse 11. Then the Passion Week covers from chapter 12, verse 12 to 19:42. And then finally we get the events occurring during the 40 days after Jesus' resurrection in chapters 20 and 21. Almost 40% of the gospel is devoted to the final week of Jesus' life, starting with the triumphal entry into Jerusalem in John 12:12. 40%, that's a lot. The account of the Passion Week focuses on Jesus' private instructions to his disciples, whereas the other three mostly record his public teachings and disputes with opponents. It is from John that we are able to ascertain the length of Jesus' ministry, approximately 3.5 years, and we get this because it's based on the number of Passover feasts that are observed during Jesus' ministry. The three Passovers are mentioned in John 2:23, 6:4, and 11:55. So one of the things that sets this gospel apart from the others is that it features extended conversations with Jesus. In the synoptics, you often get proverb-like statements from Jesus. John's gospel gives us a whole lot more depth. You get a real sense of Jesus' personality in this gospel. For example, Jesus' incredible discussion with Nicodemus, almost an argument at points. How am I supposed to get back in my mother's womb? Come on. And then the Samaritan woman at the well in chapter 4. That's an incredible conversation. Another unique feature is that Jesus' miracles or signs, as they're referred to here, are often lead-ins to teachings. Jesus uses the signs to illustrate a deeper spiritual truth to his disciples. For example, the feeding of the 5,000 in John 6 leads into Jesus explaining that he is the bread of life. John 11:25, Jesus tells Mary that he is the resurrection and the life, and shortly thereafter goes out and raises her brother Lazarus from the dead. The writer of this book records multiple instances where people misunderstood what Jesus has said and then goes on to explain what he actually meant, sometimes through further dialogue with Jesus, or the writer just comes out and says, this is what Jesus meant. For example, in John chapter 3, when Jesus tells Nicodemus that he must be born again, Nicodemus, how do I get back in my mother's womb? Jesus goes on to explain that what he is actually talking about is a spiritual rebirth. And in John chapter 2, Jesus drives the money changers out of the temple, and the Jews demand a sign. How is it that you think you can do this? Show us. We want a sign. And he says, okay, destroy this temple, and in 3 days, I will raise it up. Now, the Jews, of course, assume that he's talking about the physical temple that they're all standing in. In verse 21, the author tells us, in an aside, that the temple that Jesus was actually referring to was his body and not the physical temple. Now, if you have spent any amount of time in the Calvary Chapel churches, you will have heard the phrase, the best commentary on the Bible is the Bible itself. With the deep theological issues that are brought out in this book, either through the words of the author or from Jesus himself, this text serves as a primer or a key to understanding the rest of the Bible. For example, in the last passage I spoke to you about, since Jesus compares his body to the physical temple, you can be sure that everything about the temple, and therefore by extension the tabernacle before it, is in some way a picture of Jesus. Somehow everything about the tabernacle and the temple points to Jesus. Now, John primarily focuses on Jesus' divinity, but this gospel also shows us some other incredible things. It shows us Jesus as the Christ in John 4:25 and 26, the Samaritan woman at the well. We're waiting for this guy to come. I'm the guy. I am that Messiah. Jesus as fully human in John 1:14, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And it shows us Jesus as a humble servant with the washing of the disciples' feet in John 13:1-17. This gospel gives us really a complete picture of Jesus, the Christ, the Son of God. Thus, the gospel, according to John, is a great place to start seekers and new believers. Get them over that first verse, and the rest of that book is an awesome display of who Jesus is. So now let's talk about, I think that's everything that's fit to print for now on John. Let's talk about the four gospels as a whole. Girls, you three. Which writer in the New Testament wrote the most? Come on, give it a shot. Adam, how about you? Which gospel writer wrote the most of the New Testament? Don't know. How many of you think it's Paul? John? Really? Who is it? No. No. If you go by Paul, If you go by number of books written, absolutely it's Paul. He wrote 13 books. He seems to be the most prolific writer. And John wrote 5 books. But is that an accurate measure? I believe the more accurate measure would be a word count, right? How much did they get in? All right, by word count. And if you go by that metric, the actual most prolific writer in the New Testament would be none other than Luke, the physician. He wrote 37,932 words, 27.48% of the entire New Testament in 2 books. That's pretty awesome. Paul, by contrast, wrote 32,406 words, 23.48%. If you add in Hebrews, because I still think Paul wrote Hebrews, some don't. If you add Hebrews to his total, he's still at 37,361 and comes in 600 words under Luke. That's a lot of writing. And John comes in at 4th. Oh, sorry, John is 4th. John is 3rd. Sorry, I put Paul and then Paul with Hebrews, and it threw me off. It's Luke, Paul, John. Okay. 11 events from the life of Jesus make it into all 4 Gospels. They are Jesus' baptism by John, the feeding of the 5,000, the only miracle recorded in all 4 Gospels, Peter's profession that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, that's in all 4 Gospels, Mary anointing Jesus before his death, Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem, the Last Supper, the events in Gethsemane, Jesus on trial, the crucifixion, Jesus' burial, and Jesus' resurrection. Notice that 4 through 11 were all from the last week of Jesus' life. The narrative in all 4 of the Gospels is incredibly heavily weighted towards the end of Jesus' life. It's been said that each of the Gospels is the story of the Passion with a really long introduction. The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ is the paramount event in each of the Gospels. Everything else is just leading up to that. And you can see this. You can see how important it was to these men by how they acted after it happened. You can see it in the book of Acts. When there is preaching, it's all about the death, burial, and resurrection. Jesus claimed to be God, the living God, creator of everything. Only that creator of life could have power over death. If Jesus didn't conquer the grave, then he isn't God. Without the resurrection, the life he lived and the promises he made are meaningless. Without the resurrection, there is no good Without the resurrection, these 4 books would simply be a collection of anecdotes and clever sayings from a deluded Jewish rabbi who thought he was God. Resurrection of Jesus from the dead is the proof that he is who he said he was. And if he is who he said he was, then we can confidently believe everything else he said. Why does all this matter? Why are we talking about this? While doing my research for this teaching, I was just constantly frustrated by a certain phrase that I kept finding. Over and over in study Bibles and commentaries that I turned to for information, I kept running into one of the following phrases. Church history held that so-and-so was the author of this text until the 1800s. Or it was believed that this book was written at such and such a time until the 1800s. Over and over again, I read that some issue surrounding the gospel was held as fact until the 1800s. What the heck happened in the 1800s? It was during the 1800s that several branches of literary investigation reached their pinnacle. The two are textual criticism, also called lower criticism, and historical criticism, also called higher criticism. I don't know why one's higher and one's lower, but let's look at historical or higher criticism, because it's the one most at fault here. Historical criticism, also known as historical critical method or higher criticism, is a branch of criticism, and you got to know that something's wrong is when it's just called criticism, that investigates the origins of ancient texts in order to understand the world behind the text. From Wikipedia, the primary goal of historical criticism is to discover the text's primitive or original meaning in its original historical context and its literal sense, or sensus literalis historicus, because that just makes it sound like a magic spell. The secondary goal seeks to establish a reconstruction of the historical situation of the author and the recipients of the time that may be accomplished by reconstructing the true nature of the events that the text describes. An ancient text may also serve as a document record or source for reconstructing the ancient past, which also serve as a chief interest to the historical critic. In regard to Semitic biblical interpretation, they can't even call it the Bible of Jesus, the Semitic Bible biblical interpretation, the historical critic would be able to interpret the literature of Israel as well as the history of Israel. In layman's terms, does the external historical record match what is described within the text? On many levels, this sounds like a useful line of study. In fact, we do it all the time. And in the right context, is very useful in understanding the Bible. But in the hands of ungodly men, it can have quite a different result. Higher criticism reached its pinnacle in the 1800s, as we said. A group of men referred to as the higher critics was formed at the Tübingen School of Theology in Baden-Württemberg, Germany. Let me talk to you about a couple of these gems. First one is Ferdinand Christian Bauer. He studied a group called the Clementines, an early Judeo-Christian sect that held the teachings of Paul were heretical and followed only the true teachings of the 12 apostles. From that, he developed a theory that there were actually two branches of Christianity: Pauline, or Gentile Christianity, which held Christ as God, and Petrine, or Peter branch, Jewish Christianity, that advocated acknowledging Jesus as the Christ while maintaining the observance of Jewish customs and rituals such as circumcision. He wasn't God. This is his theory. And based on this theory, he put forth the idea that the two branches of Christianity had to grow together over time. He went on to claim that the book of Acts and the Gospel of John were written by the church in the second half of the second century to help marry the two divergent branches of Christianity into one. Most of his work and theories have been shown to be bogus, but somehow his writings have managed to turn Christian scholarship on its ear, literally upside down. And his heretical ideas have wormed their way into every area of biblical study, even now. Most notably, he has managed to cast doubt over the dates that the Gospels were written and thus their authorship. The next fella is Dr. David Friedrich Strauss. He is the father of the search for the historical Jesus movement. This guy is a gem of gems. Strauss put forth the idea that the only truth there is about Jesus is what can be corroborated by historical records outside of the church or the biblical record. If you can't prove it by some other way, it didn't happen. Thus, all that is actually true about Jesus is that he lived, he was Jewish, he taught some stuff, and he was baptized by John the Baptist. That's all we can verify, so that's all that's true. Oh, and he was crucified by the Roman Empire. Everything else, made up. He stated that Jesus was not deity, and that all the miracles performed by Jesus were myths invented by the church to further their claims. In the early 1830s, he published a book called Das Leben Jesu, or in English, The Life of Jesus Critically Examined, in which he set forth these ideas, and it was a sensation in Europe. It exploded and was read everywhere. The Earl of Shaftesbury, apparently a godly man, in 1864 called the English translation of this book the most pestilential book ever vomited out of the jaws of hell. Direct quote. While laughable to us, this work was incredibly and profoundly influential. Strauss's work spawned what is now called the Quest for the Historical Jesus Movement. And by the end of the 1800s, his work had inspired others to write hundreds, literally hundreds, of outlandish Lives of Jesus books. You have no idea how this has wormed and weaseled its way into everything. Everything. You've been influenced by it. I promise you, you just don't know it. His work spawned a second quest movement in 1953 and a third that started in the 1980s, Quest for the Historical Jesus. These movements continue to influence biblical scholarship and our culture at large to this day. This heresy is being taught in liberal seminaries right now. And if you happen to tune in to the National Geographic Channel, the Discovery Channel, the Learning Channel, some of those other ones around Christmas and Easter, you will see how did an itinerant Jewish rabbi who never claimed to be God change the world with a new religion? Thursday at 8 on National Geographic. Right now, it's being perpetrated on us, and people who don't know any better, and some people who I think should know any better, watch this stuff. And it's gotten into other programs. Maybe it's not labeled that, but they're doing a historical, archaeological dig. And, well, you know, the historical Jesus. Watch out for that word. If you hear the historical Jesus, get away from it. Get away from it just to be safe. Maybe I'm... Get away from that term. Because it's full of this. It's really ugly. Now we have something called the synoptic problem. Synoptic Gospels in many places are very similar. In other places, they are remarkably similar, and in a few places, they are identical. The early church saw this, acknowledged it, and had no problem whatsoever with it for 1,700 years. Suddenly, with the rise of historical criticism in the late 17th and early 1800s, this became a problem. In fact, it became known as the synoptic problem. Crux of this problem is, because the Synoptic Gospels are so similar, it is humanly impossible that each author worked independently, so they must have cheated off of each other. That's the story. And I know it sounds laughable to us, but when you read your Bible, if you have a study Bible, and read the introductions, oh, we don't know. We don't know. We don't understand. This has invaded church scholarship. The colleges that are supposed to be training our pastors and leaders
are teaching this garbage. So I want you to be aware of it. Because the synoptic gospels are so similar, it's humanly impossible for them to have worked independently. They've cheated off each other. The predominant theory that developed was that since 91% of the book of Mark also appears in Matthew and Luke, the Gospel of Mark must have been written first, and the authors of the other two Gospels, writers copied off that. And that totally throws off the timeline. Everybody says Matthew wrote first, but these guys insist Mark had to have so that Matthew could cheat off him. There's a problem with this theory, though. It didn't explain where the unique content found in Matthew and Luke's gospel came from. If you remember from last week, a third of Luke's gospel is completely unique. So where did that come from? And this is a problem for the higher critics. So they literally invented an explanation for it. Out of thin air, they proposed that there was another gospel written by some unknown source, which came to be called the Q document. Be careful of that. You'll hear about it. The Q document. Q document theory, they told the story that this document contained all the events and sayings that are in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and then the writers of the Synoptic Gospels all copied off of this document. One giant cheat sheet for all of them to use. Literally a theory invented out of thin air. There is zero evidence for it. No one has ever heard of it or seen it. It's just a proposed theoretical. It's Bigfoot. No one even claims to know someone who knew someone who had an uncle whose best friend's ex-girlfriend claims to have seen it. Q is Bigfoot and the Loch Ness Monster. They invented this theory to plug the holes in their other theories. Their other made-up stuff they came up with, there must be a Q. The Q document was recorded on tan Sasquatch hides using a unicorn horn for a pen and written with Kraken ink thinned with fairy tears. And I want it to be that ridiculous because I want you to know how ridiculous these people are. And they're not just frauds, they're inconsistent frauds. How inconsistent are they, Pastor Carl? Well, let me tell you. These same pinheads, while claiming that the Synoptic Gospels were not genuine work of the named authors because they are too much alike, also proliferated the idea that the Gospel of John was not John's work because it was so different from the Synoptics. You know what? I can handle anybody's argument, but you better be consistent because I will jump all over inconsistency. You can't argue that it's too consistent over here, and that makes it a fraud, but it's not consistent enough over here, so it's a... No. Tell me, what is your preferred consistency level? Excuse me, I'm going all Midwest for a moment. What else is happening in the world at this time? And this is telling. You get an even greater idea of what is actually at play here when you consider two other major events that happened around this time. And know this is all happening at the tail end or just after the Great Enlightenment, when humanism rose up in society, that man is the be-all, live-all, do-all, end-all. Then this happens, and then at this or around the same time, these two other events. On November 24th, 1959, the book On the Origin of Species by Charles Darwin was published. 1848, a German-born atheist of Jewish heritage named Karl Marx published his pamphlet, The Communist Manifesto. This is the same land where 300 years earlier, the Reformation took place. And it ushered Europe out of the Dark Ages. It birthed scientific discovery. The Reformation changed the world. 300 years later, starting in the birthplace of that Reformation, the devil began to use so-called scholarly men to cast doubt on almost every tenet of the Christian faith. How many remember what came out of that? What? The five solas? Scripture alone, grace alone, faith alone, Christ alone, glory of God alone. It all begins with what? Scripture alone. So if you can destroy that, if you can destroy people's trust in the scriptures, then the rest of them fall too, don't they? Without the witness of the Bible, grace, faith, Christ, and God are nothing. So the devil is constantly leading men to call into question the veracity of the scriptures. And the devil continued that work of the higher critics through Darwin in England and Marx also in Germany. And that devil's work bore great fruit. 100 years, less than 100 years from this, after the systematic destruction of the scriptures in Germany that spread throughout Europe, followed by the birth of the theory of evolution, we don't need God to explain things, we can do it now, and the birth of communism, we can see the effects that those things had on the continent of Europe where all of this first took place. 1914, World War I. 1917, the Communist Revolution in Russia. Millions killed. 1930s, the rise of Nazism. Complete godlessness takes over a country. 1939, World War II, leading to the extermination of 6 million Jews and the spread of communism until it covered roughly half of Europe. Godlessness. The communist God is the communist state. There is no room for God in communism. Half of Europe. And it spilled over into a large portion of Asia. Anybody think that's a coincidence? Anybody think it's a coincidence when you destroy the scriptures and you take God out of society that that's the result? And it continues today. Now, I originally did this almost 5 years ago, so I had to update my numbers. Gallup's annual beliefs and morals poll, included in that are what people think about the Bible, and it just happened to have a 2022 edition. They do it every 5 years. Last one was 2017. 20% of all people think the Bible is the actual Word of God. 20%, that's it. And this has been declining for over 40 years. It's not a great number, but it was 38% in 1976. Now it's 20. It had dropped a couple of points since the 2017 poll. 49% of all people think the Bible is the inspired Word of God, but is not meant to be taken literally. Again, up 2% from the 2017 poll when I first did this. 29% of all people think the Bible is an ancient book of fables, including increasing over 40 years. It was, that number was only 13% in 1976. 300% more people think the Bible is an ancient book of fables. And here is the absolutely saddest finding of all. Of all adults who self-identify as Christian, I want you to hear that. All adults who self-identify as Christian, only 25% of them consider the Bible the actual Word of God. It all starts when men in their own understanding, try to explain the things of God. How we got these books? Hand of God. How these guys wrote it? Hand of God. Every time men try to explain what God does, they destroy people's faith. They destroy people's belief system. And you see the results. You see it over and over again in the Gospel of John. But I think Paul wrote to show this abandonment of God and what the results are best in Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1, 16 through 32. If you got a minute, turn there. If you got your Bibles, let's just read this together. God keeps bringing me back to this passage of Scripture over and over and over again, because I think it so perfectly describes where we're at today. Beginning at verse 16, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also the Greek. For in the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness, because what may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has shown it to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image like corruptible man, and birds, and four-footed animals, and creeping things. Therefore, see the result of discounting God. Therefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness in the lusts of their hearts to dishonor their bodies among themselves, who exchanged the truth of God for the lie and worshiped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this reason, God gave them up to vile passions, for even their women exchanged the natural use for what is against nature. Likewise, also men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust for one another, men with men committing what is shameful and receiving in themselves the penalty of their error, which was due. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind to do those things which are not fitting, being filled with all unrighteousness, sexual immorality, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, evil-mindedness. They are whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, violent, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, undiscerning, untrustworthy, unloving, unforgiving, unmerciful, who, knowing the righteous judgment of God, that those who practice such things are deserving of death, not only do the same, but also approve of those who practice them." What Paul tells us here, and we can see it, is that the root of man's corruption is the denial of God's revelation of himself. His final and greatest revelation of himself was in the God-man Jesus Christ. Deny that revelation and watch society crumble into the chaos of its own perversion. Look around you, family. It is happening, and this is why. If the people who had a problem with the Synoptic Gospels had only read and believed what they actually said they read, they would actually see the answer to the Synoptic problem. John 14:26. "But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and Bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. If four guys heard it, the account of what Jesus said should be pretty consistent, shouldn't it? Especially when God's helping you remember it. The events recorded in the Gospels are not just memories of men. Yes, they saw them. Yes, they recounted them. But they are memories being curated in their minds, preserved, and brought forward by the Spirit of God. He is the one working behind the scenes to make sure that the details given are accurate. So if we believe that and we start doubting the Bible, who are we actually doubting? We're doubting God. And Paul tells us in Timothy 3:16 and 17, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. Gospel writers wrote exactly what God wanted them to write. In a sense, the synoptic problem people are correct. There is a cue, and it's God. What's the point of all this? Why are we doing this? Again, let's look at 1 Corinthians 2, 12 through 15. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit who is from God, that we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God. These things we also speak, not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, nor can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. But he who is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is rightly judged by no one. If we want to understand the Word of God, we cannot do it on our own. We need the Spirit of God, the Spirit of Jesus, His Holy Spirit to teach us. And that is what we should be earnestly asking for every time we pick up this book. That's why we do it every Sunday. I could just jump into the message, but we need God here. And when men devoid of God try to interpret God's word, they make hash out of it. And I promise you, personally, that if you ask for that thing, you will get it. And I know that in two ways. First is because Jesus said so. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, this is a Luke 11:13. How much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? So if you're at it, you're going to get it. Jesus says so. And I can tell you on this one specific thing, that if you pray for understanding of God's word, you will get it. It is the one prayer I have never been denied, ever in my life. Sometimes it comes real quick. Sometimes it's a slow thing. But I've never been denied understanding of God's word, ever. And when it does come, actually that little delay is kind of cool, because you've kind of, well, you don't really remember that you prayed for it, and then suddenly it drops in your lap. You're like, oh, dude, I was just asking about that. That's so cool. And it's right there. It's the one thing that if we do. But all of this is spiritually discerned. If we come in under our own juice and our own power trying to understand this, you're not gonna. It's not gonna make sense. And as we're about to embark on this study of the greatest story ever told, contained within the pages of this book, and it's told to us by the writings of these men, so knowing that what they tell us is true and faithful is unspeakably important. If you don't believe that this book is real and genuine and true, and we have evidence to prove that it is, then I can speak to you out of it all day long and it won't make any difference, because it's just myths and fables and fairy tales. But if you believe that this is the word of God, what choice do you have but to listen and obey? But listen and do what it calls us to do right now. And what it calls us to do, what the whole thing is put here for. 66 writers, all saying the same thing, all leading us to the same point. You need Jesus. Dude, I'm just saying, you need Jesus. Thousands of years of history and time and countless numbers of people all pointing to the same thing. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. So as we get into the life of everything that that book points to and existed to get us to, do you believe it? If you do, this story will change your life. You will hear things in this that maybe you've never heard, or maybe you haven't heard in a long time, and it will change your day, your month, your week, and your year if you believe it's true and give yourself over to it. It's going to be awesome. Thank you, Father, for all that you've done for us, the incredible effort you went to preserve this story, these truths, these facts for each of us. It's wonderful. And I don't think we talk often enough about what this says about who you are and how much and how deeply you must love us to put in this much effort. Father, I ask that every single person would leave here today with a sense deep in their heart and at the forefront of their mind, a deep sense of how much this all points to your love for us. And then let us take that love out into the world and show it to whoever we can. And all this I ask in the blessed, beautiful name of Jesus. Amen.